Okay, folks, may I ask that everybody get seated? We'll start the second half of the morning session. Especially you, Greg. Okay, folks, may I ask if we get seated and we'll get started right now. Thank you very much. The door will be closing soon.
Told me what to say. So this is Chris Garrett. I'm kidding. So our next speaker is Trevor McDougall. Trevor has been involved in extensive work in many topics. One of them is the thermodynamics of seawater. But he's also been looking at ocean mixing and how it's represented in climate models, which he'll talk about today. He obtained his PhD from the University of Cambridge, but has spent most of his time doing research in Australia. So please join me in welcoming Trevor.
So my first remarks involve Walter and skiing. And the first time I met Walter, I think he was probably about my present age. And he came to Canberra to do some job interviews for the head of CSIRO. And I was assigned the task of picking up Walter from the airport. And so I went along my sports car, and of course I'd forgotten that there was Judy, there was Kendall, there was a wheelchair, and there's two sets of skis. So that's a common thing there. So I'm sure he managed it somehow with a taxi as well as the car. And then later, a couple of weeks later, or days later, Walter and Judy had us around for dinner. And one of the things he said to me, I'd never forgotten, he said, Trevor, some years ago, the university gave me some money to build a new building for the group, the IGBP. And he said, I had the devil of a job to get it built the way I wanted, with the right ratio of lab space and office space and atrium. And he said, you know, the only way I got it built the way I wanted was to sleep with the architect. And I thought, wow. All right, so...
did you follow that?
With that? So he's a wonderful role model, obviously. So I first started thinking about the deep ocean when I attended an Aha Bulakoa workshop in 1989. And I want to just talk about the overall structure here of a density surface, sinking of a bottom water plume, which is in training, and I'll talk about the fact that the area of the ocean is increasing with height. And this simple equation came from the proceedings of that workshop. So this is the volume transport, upwelling of bottom water, the area of the ocean, and the dipole velocity. If you put that as the dipole velocity equals Q over A and differentiate it, you find that both of these terms are negative. So in order to explain the Stolt-Nielsen's upwelling, the overall budget for the ocean, the fact that this entrains, the fact that the area is an increasing function of height, says the sign of Stolt-Nielsen's is back to front from both perspectives. So that got me interested in this boundary mixing issue. All right, so revisiting this canonical paper of Walter's from 1966, the abyssal recipes paper, we have this one-dimensional balance of the diapical velocity, diapical diversity operating on some tracer, could be density. And what more to deal with? He assumed he knew what the upwelling rate was, and he assumed he knew the length scale for the rate at which the buoyancy frequency increased with height, and that gave him the diffusivity of one Mach. But I'd like to point out that using this relationship of Tom Osborne's, that there's a direct relationship between the diffusivity and the dissipation. It says that if the buoyancy or the stratification increases with height, then so should the dissipation increase with height if the diffusivity is constant. But we know ever since this other groundbreaking work of Poulsen and others from Montol during the Bose Rizal Basin experiment that this was a watershed, I think, in terms of understanding mixing in the ocean and the fact that it increases with depth towards the bottom more recently in the Southern Ocean. And so what that says is that this buoyancy balance where you have the diapical velocity is roughly equal to the rate at which this dissipation increases with height is negative. So we have sinking. So how do we get bottom water coming up in the ocean if we have sinking on each cast? On each cast that we observe, we have water going down. How does the water on average go up? And so a few of us have been working on that the last 3 or 4 years. And I want to explain one of those papers. The key is the fact that the ocean doesn't have vertical walls. And so this is what I have in mind, is that there's some isopichons that are flat, there's some topography, and talking about these density surfaces, there's a well-mixed layer here that's uniformly unstratified, and then a region of stratification in the interior.
Hey, Trevor, can I interrupt at this point? Oh, sorry, Chris, this is Trevor here. Okay,
Trevor, you can talk later on.
Why do the petals go like that? That would happen with constant diffusivity as you go away from the boundary. But if you're just mixing near the boundary, the isopetals will be normal to the sloping bottom, then come up and overshoot a bit, and then come back down again.
Thanks for that insight, to Trevor.
So why have you drawn it wrong, is my question, really.
Don't you mean wrongly to get the English correct? Because I'm a simple person, I'm just doing it schematic. I don't argue
with that. Trevor, I think, do you agree that actually if you just switch near the bottom, even before all sorts of other flow set in, the isopical would not look like that?
Yes.
In my simple world, Chris, the actual shape of the isopicals as a function of Cartesian coordinates is unimportant. What's important is the flow through them. And so this is fine for my purposes. Thanks, Trevor. Okay, so I'm going to do a simple analysis of this sloping boundary.
When I go to the ocean.
And this is the warm mixed layer here.
My
and
ocean
then
doesn't look like that. Does it matter?
It doesn't look like this or that.
Well, it's got a lot more structure, and I think fundamentally that you're drawing that line that goes into the boundary in a normal direction. We don't see that observationally very much. And the one constraint, I think, observational constraint we have is some work that Hans von Herren did and in south of England. And he was seeing that bottom boundary condition only really took hold within the bottom 2 meters. And so if you're drawing all the upwelling, kind of going upslope in that bottom boundary layer, doesn't it make this screen shift that's only 2 meters high?
Well, I think if you follow the rest of the slide, the next slide, you realize that it doesn't really matter how high that is or how we draw this. What's important is this one over here.
So there is a bottom of the ocean here. There is some area which I'm calling a warming layer, which you can argue about how deep it is. And then there's the important point is that this part ends where the buoyancy flux is maximal. And then I've got an exponential decay buoyancy. So if you're willing to live with a buoyancy flux that increases towards the bottom and then has a zero at the bottom, that's what we need to believe.
the geometry is important. So I want to make you feel comfortable with these equations. So I'm going to do a volume budget for this area here between two isopignals. And the conservation of volume, conservation of buoyancy, you combine them and you take the limit as the buoyancy difference goes to zero. You find this rather simple equation, which says the net upwelling across an isopignal is equal to the rate at which the diffusive buoyancy flux area integrated varies with buoyancy. I'm ignoring the geothermal heat flux. And this can be decomposed into an upward component and a downward component through here as the bottom mantle layer and the stratified mixing layer. So this is different to how we think about the one-dimensional ocean, mostly because this area, this diffusive buoyancy flux is the area integrated one across an area of isopignal rather than just per square metre on a vertical water column. Alright, so that's our red equation. What is this buoyancy flux again? Well, it's the area integrated diffusivity times n squared, or buoyancy sub z, which is the area integrated dissipation rate times mixing efficiency, which I just called curly B. All right, so this equation here is no more, no less than the Wahlen approach on that shaded area, and the Wahlen approach in its more glorious detail is like this that I won't go into. And one thing you can say straight away, which I made this conclusion in the Ahagulikara proceedings in 1989, was that near the top of the seamounts, because the area here available for mixing increases strongly with depth, that the buoyancy flux then changes with depth quite strongly, and so the net dipole transport in the area of the top of the seamount is downwards. So that near the top of the seamount, flow will be going down. This is simplified.
But Trevor, that assumes that the mixing doesn't increase as you go up.
Correct.
You just take the area into account and nothing else.
Yes, that's right. This is all based on the fact that the mixing is coming from zero high up to something large. I agree.
All right, so the next step is to try and relate trying to get expression for the dipole velocity in this region. And this is our regular equation for one-dimensional balance on each water column. This is, if you like, the Monk abyssal recipes balance between convection and diffusion on the water column. But now if we integrate that over this area of where the mixing is happening in the stratified mixing layer region, we can find that it's the area integral of this ratio of the buoyancy flux derivative with respect to z divided by the buoyancy squared. Keeping that in mind, we'll go do a budget study on just this area, this unstratified region. You find that the upward flow along this region is simply the buoyancy flux, the maximum value at the top of this rate layer, and then geometrical integration factors. Okay, so there we have our three equations. We've derived this one, we've stated that one as well, and this one here. Three different equations for the net and the BBL, the SML transports. Now we can use them. So I'm going to first of all assume that there's this profile here is exponential in the vertical. And that enables me to write the dipole velocity as proportional to the buoyancy flux, because you pick up this 1 over the vertical decay scale of this exponential profile. And that's handy because it means that this area integrated transport can be written as proportional to the flux across along the density surface. So that's a key step in what I'm doing, is to transform what was a vertical derivative of buoyancy into just the buoyancy itself, area integrated divided by length squared. So I assume to be constant at say 500 meters. All right, we're nearly the key. This there's a revision of our net upwelling, and the one, the sinking one, just in the stratified region through here. All right, so the next step is to find an expression for F, and we do that by just simply integrating this part here. So the buoyancy flux by diffusion across each density surface integrated across the whole globe is this integral from the bottom of the ocean to whatever surface you're at of the net upwelling, the bottom water upwelling rate. Okay, so now we just substitute that into this expression. Here we find the sinking, number of spurters sinking in the interior is this amount here. So it depends on the 500 meter scale, depends on the average value of n squared, but just the integral of the total upwelling velocity as a function of buoyancy. And this is negative, and then the upwelling in the water band layer is the change of sign plus the net value. So the simplest case is to take, well, imagine the upwelling of bottom water is independent of depth or buoyancy in the bottom couple of thousand meters. So then this expression becomes simply the upwelling of bottom water times the difference in buoyancy. And so the sinking velocity in the stratified interior just becomes this simple case, which is, say, if you're 3,000 metres above the bottom to where you are, and the length scale for exponential is 500, then you've got six times the net upwelling velocity as sinking, and seven times going up here. So it says that in the simple case, for if we have 20 spurters going up on average, you must have 120 coming down the interior and 140 going up. Now you can make this a bit more realistic, if you like, by taking a vertical profile of the upwelling as a function of buoyancy, like this. And when you do that, I won't go through it, you end up with pictures like this. It says, okay, if I have a maximum upwelling of 18 spurters here at some value of density of 28.1 or so, then I'll expect to have 100 or so at 3,000 metres and 80 or so sinking just outside. So that's the summary of what I've done here. This is the paper with Raf Ferrari published in March. And so the expression is based on VAL and conservation of buoyancy. The integrating to find the expression for the buoyancy flux in terms of the net upwelling, and then combining those three equations to find these factors, which seemed, because the length scale, the buoyancy scale involved here is bigger than the 500 metres, you get these factors greater than one. So the view that seems to emerge from this is that if this is a canonical sector, you have the middle of the ocean with not much happening because it's only background mixing. Then you have a region which we've called the stratified mixing layer, which could be 4 degrees of latitude wide, in which you have, say, 4 or 5 times the net upwelling rate but sinking. So, say, average waves are sinking in this cross region here, and the 100 coming up right against the boundary in these mixed regions, mixed layers. That seems to be a consequence of simple budget analysis of what is going on in the boundaries. And so it means that this picture, obviously, we can perhaps regard no more than a schematic, and because all the mixing has to happen close to the boundaries, or perhaps close to the mid-band ridges, and I think we have to redo this substantially if we're going to talk about the Stoller-Lorenz linear vorticity balance. And just to make a point that our current models that use Brian Lewis, for instance, they have a vertical profile of diffusivity, which in the bottom few thousand metres of the ocean is basically constant. So they also yield upwelling in the bottom of the ocean rather than downwelling, which is what they should be giving. So how does the ocean achieve an upwelling when it's going, when it has this downwelling through the interior? What do we need? Well, we need to have, first of all, that the most important thing the ocean must conspire to achieve is that the buoyancy, diffusive buoyancy flux, area integrated, has to be an increasing function of buoyancy. So near the bottom, that's easy to do because the circumference here is increasing with height, although there's a caveat to that. So let's have a look at what we might expect here. This is the buoyancy, area integrated buoyancy flux. L is the circumference of this surface of revolution type ocean bowl, and B naught again is the buoyancy flux maximum at the bottom of the ocean, and D is our constant 500 meter number, and the tangent of this angle is the angle that the isotope was with the bottom. So if you just differentiate that with respect to buoyancy, you find that this can be positive due to a number of reasons. Right? If we take the 500 meter scale in constant, that one doesn't appear. But this one here is the angle. So you can see that because of this low angle here, low slope and high slope here, that's led this area of significant mixing to be longer here than up here. So that works against us because that's not going to help to achieve this buoyancy flux to make this positive. This one here does help. The circumference is getting bigger with height. But the key thing, I think, is that this buoyancy flux must be an increasing function of height. And of course, even with a constant diffusivity, this is one way you can get an increasing function of height if the buoyancy frequency increases with height. This will assist. So one of the games we've been playing recently is to ask questions about, well, let's assume a constant n squared, b sub z, or an exponentially increasing one, or unrealistically, an exponentially decreasing stratification. And then we assumed a constant buoyancy flux at the bottom of the ocean, just above the bottom boundary line, just as a starting assumption. Then that specifies the shape of these buoyancy flux area integrated profiles. And then we've taken either the fact that the ocean is a laundry trough, two-dimensional, up in versions of a mid-land ridge in geometry, or we've allowed the ocean to be a surface of revolution, so it's a bowl. And then we've solved the, for a given upwelling, given 20 square meters of upwelling, we've solved what the shape of the bowl has to be, or the shape of the ridge has to be. And so this is not a very realistic shape of ocean, but for some of it tends to be this way, not that way. This is an ocean like the trumpet. It's going to span the ocean like that. That's it. It's two-dimensional, this is three-dimensional. So none of these are very realistic. This one's getting a little bit more realistic in the shape of the ocean's a bowl like that. So we take away from that the fact that you cannot reproduce today's stratification with today's geography of the ocean, the optometry, by assuming a constant buoyancy flux at the bottom. We have to have a very strong increase in buoyancy flux at the bottom of the ocean with buoyancy. So that's ongoing work. Before I finish, I wanted to open up some of the questions that my group also addressed. And this is getting to the question of,
well, we're talking about right, people mixing in this region, but how do we know that what we're observing is actually the result of breaking through waves? Perhaps it's actually a result of lateral mixing that somehow has got a very much component to it.
And so there's been a couple of papers recently, one by Jonas Nykander in JPO 2011, and a few papers by Remy Tolo, trying to answer the question of, if we have some lateral mixing, some baritone instability, how applying energetic arguments, like how do we, if we assume that these mixing processes will happen without any input of energy, what would the direction of mixing be? Would it be the neutral direction or some other direction? I'd like to rehearse how I think about this, and it basically devalues the concept of energy completely. So he published this in 2014 as a thought process. It said, imagine that lateral mixing happens such that a parcel from here was shoved across to this latitude and longitude, but it did so in a way which left it unstably stratified. So it's, instead of going along this density surface, it's a plastic bag is put around the parcel here, it's moved, and then you let the plastic, you punch the balloon, and let that dense water interact with the surroundings. Then it'll form a plume, you'll see some dissipation, the same if you in this direction. And I reckon what was will look is away from boundaries of just out of the interior, if you don't observe much mixing, much dissipation, so there can't be too much of these plumes happening, therefore the pedestrian must move along this surface. The following is such that this, when it moves here, and you took a vertical pass here, you see no vertical latitudes. So this argument we've now refined a little bit, and it's one of those papers I've written which has got about zero equations in the paper. It's super unnatural to me. So it's hand wave. So this is the idea, is that you have some shear, some mid-scale activity, and eventually the ocean can have some mixing, like the one of the spillers, let's say. And the point of this diagram is to say visually what we observe in our microstructure, and that is that as you take the vertical profile density in the ocean interior, you don't see overturns on large scales. You see overturns on the scale of the billows. Or in other words, that we see density overturns at these scales, like order of 1 metre, we don't see them tens or hundreds of metres. That is that the Thorpe scale is observed to be about the same as the Osmond scale. So the Osmond scale is the scale at which, scale at which mixing is actively turbulent, because it's got enough energy to overcome stratification and keep the mixing happening. So I take that to mean that in observations, when we have overturns, are indicative of active turbulent mixing, which you might say is, say, quasi-autotropic. At least it's turbulent in the sense that we can use the diffusivity to describe it. And you could argue about whether we should be putting some slightly different diffusivity for heat and salt. I'd argue that strong events would have the same diffusivity in salt, we would undo any small differential diffusion that happens. Big events. But now the key step is, okay, I think we're probably in the room will agree with that. What about this idea that we, having thought about that and having observed that and having even got our microstructure from these kind of observations agreeing with our lead well type sulfur dyes, data maps a function of density, are we justified in saying, right, that's one process, source scale mixing. Now we take that out of the equation, out of our thought process, and we say, right, we'll deal with that separately, we'll deal with source scale mixing and diffusion and dissipation. We know about that, we'll deal with that separately. Let's go back and now try and understand lateral mixing. So then the lateral mixing story reverts to the pitch I had a minute ago, which is this picture, because we now want to address lateral mixing knowing that there are no vertical conversions for density. And then that tells you the direction of lateral mixing. So the upshot there is that this hand-wavy series of sentences rather than equations leads to the idea that we are justified in taking the ocean mixing as the sum of two separate processes, or three if you include differential diffusion and namely, lateral mixing along these likely reference potential density surfaces, so the end result of that is a snapshot of the density would be stably stratified. And on top of that, we add in diacritical mixing of whatever size our heart desires. So I don't know if that, those last few slides, are just bleeding obvious to people in the room. They kind of aren't to me, but it's caused a fair bit of heat in the journals recently. So with that, I think I can conclude. Thank you. Correct. So the discussion is, are all these models wrong? That's what Remy would tell you. It's they're all wrong because they don't think they're right.
I got a two-part question. Hi, Trevor. Oh, Chris.
I'm the better-looking version of Chris.
So this is lovely. Question geographically, though. The buoyancy input is largely low latitude, subtropics and tropics. And so one has to think about how you get the heat down where you need it, where it's coming from, where the sun's putting it in. So does one look for intersections of boundaries with the surface in those low latitudes? Also, a lot of the boundaries where mixing is happening, it's the second half, I should ask, is along mid-ocean ridges, which don't go to the surface. So you're going to get upwelling up to about 2,000 meters if you follow this. And then you get an enhanced kappa, as Kurt and all have shown, above the ridge, but the water goes, whoops, I'm here. So when we look at isopycnals crossing mid-ocean ridges, we see the dive into the sides below the ridge top, and we see a bowing of an isopycnal over the top, maybe because of the flow around the ridge, but it may be because of the mixing or some indication of W. Have you taken it that far to see where you can link this to the actual locations of upwelling?
We haven't taken that far geographically, but just conceptually. And also, Tim Lembles has a little comment out, submitted to JPO. Yes, first of all, my whole talk was only about the very deep ocean. So just bringing up dense water to the density surface sufficient so that it could then come adiabatically to the surface in the Southern Ocean. So you're right to concentrate on nothing shallower than 2,000 metres, for instance, 2,500. But what's important here is the area integrated buoyancy, diffusive buoyancy flux, my uppercase F. It doesn't matter whether it happens on the side of a seamount or the side of a wind lake ridge or a side of a continent. It just has to have that thing proceeding nicely with the vertical increasing nicely. That'll give you upwelling, and as long as you get it to the density class that can outcrop adiabatically, I think our conscience is clear as far as solving the missing mixing problem.
I guess I would say that the second part of Stamoulerin's that doesn't work, in addition to uniform upwelling everywhere, is uniform buoyancy flux everywhere. So it would just, that's
okay, so the first part of your question was how does the buoyancy get there? So the negative buoyancy gets there by the sinking of Antarctic bottom water plumes. But if it wasn't for a diffusive flux of buoyancy across, say, 2,500 metres or something, then as we heard in the first talk, the bottom 2,000 or 3,000 metres of the ocean would just fill up with dense water. So yes, there has to be there has to be an F across those depths that we're talking about. That's the mathematical answer to your physical question.
So the question I have is that we have climate models, and maybe they work pretty well or they don't. So I guess the question is, do you think that climate models aren't working well? Because one of the things that people have tried doing is putting in they put in mixing through some energetic argument, and then you have some structure where the diffusivity decreases
So, this remark here. So until we had these have had these bottom intensified mixing schemes in ocean models, yes, I believe that the bottom 2,000 or 3,000 meters have been uploading their water incorrectly. They've been uploading their bottom water throughout the interior, and if we'd cared to look at that, if we'd cared to look at the overturning in density coordinates, but in density and space as well, we would have seen that. And so the question is how much damage does that do? But the second part of your question was about, well, now we are putting in some bottom intensified mixing, then that's going to solve this problem. We'll actually get, if we care to look at them, like RAF has, RAF and Ali, in a paper late last year. I just wanted to get back to this picture somewhere. Is that all we'll do? Yes.
Do see, in fact, an upwelling that's three times the downwelling. Depending on the geometry, depending exactly on how you specify the shape of your parabola or whatever your pushing topography is, and etc.
But the point I'd like to hear a lot of discussion about is, okay, so we've got this theoretical result. So, you know, that might account for like 15 or 20% of this term if you add on the volume equation state and add on the mixing efficiency.
Was that Jody?
Yes, I do have the mic. Trevor, I like the toy models that you had where you did the different shapes of the bottom bathymetry and looked at the upwelling. I guess we think that the energy that's put into mixing from tides or from mean flows depends on n squared. So have you guys tried changing b naught so that it actually varies with n squared?
So we have done a bit of trying of just simply having a constant diffusivity. So we put in N squared, put a shape in here. And so, you know, we can let that be there and then play with. Yeah, and I haven't got the results here, but it's just got the draft paper yesterday, actually. Sort of games you can play. There is a, just to, on that score, I mean, since this week was designed to have lots of talking after the presentation. One thing that I think about sometimes is if the mixing efficiency is a function of n squared, or of which is a number, and if you have a steady state, if you like, and then you have the perturbance such that the buoyancy frequency decreases, then your buoyancy flux decreases, and in a non-linear way. So you can get a runaway situation in which there isn't any capital F at 2,000 meters lin, and the whole thing just becomes homogeneous. So, you know, it's fine for us to play these games where we set the stratification or set the buoyancy flux, but the real ocean has this link between the two, which is non-linear and...
Trevor, if h, your small h, was 2 meters, just for the sake of argument, what would be the implied upslope velocities, and are they measurable?
I don't know the answer off the top of my head for what they are, but they'd certainly be keeping you awake at night, I think. Is that measurable?
Can I respond a bit to that? Because I think you bring much more power to an instantaneous measure that goes back to clearly talking about an average state. So just how the variables can start defining the average state.
No, Von Hart is a time average over 2-3 weeks.
No, but he's instantaneously, and he's talking when his accuracy in active turbulence, you know, the destabilizing effect on that boundary layer is very thin. He doesn't know what is the long time average over which the buoyancy flux, if you average over the time scale of the large scale circulation, would be. So, yes, instantaneously those velocities can be very large. On average, they're going to be much smaller.
Another way of twisting your question around, Kurt, would be if you can't find a hole in the 6 lines of mathematics up here, then and you don't like the velocity upslope that you get with 2 meters, then sort of the answer is it must be 200 meters.
Well, okay. What I'm kind of objecting here is that in one of the issues that roughness brings with it, so that very wonderful picture of mixing across the Brazil Basin, where it's all along the right-hand side of the plot and it's all roughness, is that what you find is that the abyssal hills that give rise to that roughness have a spectrum in which the length of line segments increases as you go to smaller and smaller scales for measuring. So it's fractured. Within hypsometric arguments that are based upon line segments, then you're getting a lot of increasing area and potential for upwelling over those abyssal hills. And so it's not the bowl. My ocean is not the bowl that you have drawn and you're doing your calculations on. It is the fact that you have this roughness over mid-ocean ridges, which is providing mixing, and that also supports upwelling through hypsometric arguments. And that's what's being left out. And yeah, the 6 lines of mathematics are fine. They are. But it's just, this is not my ocean.
But this is everyone's ocean, even yours.
So this is a slice on a slice of pickle, right? And this is, well, it looks like a church.
Our problem is the continental boundaries end up like sediment that's come in from erosion.
Yeah.
So it's the when that area integration happens across a very fractal regions or whatever, is the material.
I come from an institute that does climate research, where the ocean modelling is one component of the whole climate model. And I'm so a bit surprised about there seems to be a divorce between the ideas that are developing here and what the climate models are doing. And I found your comment that, well, the ocean models are probably wrong, which is very interesting. Wouldn't it be good to interact with these climate models to say all your models are wrong, suggest you do this, and see what happens if you do this and see if it comes up better or not? Because there's a lot of discussion of the role of ocean models in the climate system and the whole question of the aegis of the global warming that was due to the large heat uptake with oceans and so forth. I mean, all of these discussions become very questionable if you really think that the underlying physics that we're modeling in these models is missing some very important aspects. So I feel you should be doing these things in collaboration with climate modelers to see whether this or that process that you think is very important really has an impact on the climate system or not. And I think the discussion between these two disciplines would be very fruitful for both sides.
Yeah, I agree with the class. So, as I said, there was two references to the ocean models all wrong. One was quoting the papers of Remy Tellot, which I don't think are correct. I don't think the ocean models are wrong to the extent that you get from reading his papers. But the other thing is, I said here, that the parameterizations we've been using for diapigonal mixing have been getting the diapigonal velocity the wrong sign throughout the bulk of the ocean in the bottom, a few thousand meters. Now we have more modern parameterizations that do have bottom intensification of mixing. They'll be doing it more correctly. On the end. So I think it is happening.
Observationally, to address that, of course, the ocean is observationally in near geostrophic balance. And this is empirical, if you like. And anything like mixing and so forth has to leave the ocean model in near geostrophic balance. And in some sense, the gross structure is going to be independent. The observational gross structure is going to be independent of a lot of the detail that goes on in these schemes.
No, can I respond? Because that is irrelevant. It is in geostrophic balance, but the diapigonal velocity is the part that is not. So the whole overturning is not. And to answer the question, we are working with ocean modelers to actually look into the effect of having the diapigonal mixing increasing towards the bottom. So this is being done.
Unfortunately,
may I make one comment before they shut us off? It's actually several. Trevor, I have a poster which answers Lynn's question a little bit about where the mixing is going on, and the other thing about where the buoyancy comes from, it definitely does come from basically subduction, North Atlantic deep water coming down, et cetera, to bring the buoyancy that has to go down further. The other thing is, it's going to alleviate a little bit of the amount of mixing that you need, is you're leaving out entrainment of the bottom water as you go down, right? You've got 20 sphere drops and you're leaving out.
No, I didn't leave it out.
Yes, you have. Because you don't in what you said, but you don't need to bring 20 sphere drops up all the way through because of the training.
Yeah, so I had that in my grasp that at the next uploading and maximizing
Okay, great discussion, everyone. Thanks. Ray is another observational oceanographer who has spent many cumulative years at sea. He received his PhD from Rhode Island in 1978, the year I was born. and he He's been one of the leaders on the East Coast developing one of the first microstructure profilers, the HRP, the High Resolution Profiler. He has worked on a wide range of topics. They include ocean mixing and microstructure, double diffusive convection, thermohaline circulation, only to name a very few. So please join me in welcoming Ray.
Yeah, I wanted to tell the story of that figure that Trevor just showed, and which has been shown hundreds of times over the years. I've in the WOS era, you'll hear a lot about this, I guess. In the WOS era, it was featured as one of the primary results of WOS, this section of dissipation across the Brazil Basin, and mixing coefficient across the Brazil Basin. And it was highlighted as one of the primary results of the WOS experiment, the World Ocean Circulation Experiment. But I always like to point out to the WOS Steering Committee that they refused to endorse it, the dissipation measurements as part of the Deep Tracer experiment. So we had to get our own funding. But anyway, so this is our famous figure, and I'll tell you why I'm using that term, malice aforethought. We had already done a few dives to the deep ocean, and we had a pretty good idea of what we were going to find, and so I laid out the cruise track so that we would be able to make such a figure. So I look for deep turbulence. It really does go back to month 66. And for me, it was a chance encounter with Chip Cox. I sort of have a remote connection to Walter. He was on John Knaus's committee, and John Knaus was on mine at the University of Rhode Island. And I recently became two-thirds the age of Walter. And I started grad school in 72 when that paper was only 6 years old. So it was very much a part of my graduate education. And there were Mike had a bunch of papers up there. There were two other papers from 59 issue of TELUS, a Robinson and Stommel paper and a Volander paper. The first one having some mixing in it, and Volander's was kind of a start on the ventilated thermocline kind of approach. So those three papers sort of informed my graduate education in thermocline. And the thermocline problem at that time looked to be a really good one. So I did work on salt fingers for my PhD with Mel Stern. And when I was in Rhode Island, we had a couple of cruises early on in my graduate education. And in 74, I went out with Dave Evans and Tom Rosby using a shear profiler. This was a CTD, long tube, went to a certain depth and dropped its weights. And had acoustic current meters on the bottom. These were invented by a Norwegian group, and Tom had merged them with CTD. And back in those days, we had to record data on tape recorders, and there were lots of handling problems, which informed my later approach to designing HRP. You'd pluck this thing out of the water and winch it up, and inevitably you hit it against the side of the ship, and then the neck down where the acoustic current meters that were attached would break. And so they had a tough cruise with that. So I went to Hui on a postdoc fellowship to work with Sandy Williams, and he had a very squat profiler, optical profiler, the self-contained microstructure profile, imaging microstructure profiler, and used it on a cruise in 1980. And it had a CTD, an acoustic current meter. And I thought that was a great combination because you could do the density ratio to determine the local conditions for the salt fingers and diffusive convection. And you could do the Richardson number, computer Richardson number. So in 1981, I was a newly appointed scientist at HUI. And I was invited to a workshop on dispersal from deep ocean sources. This was Department of Energy had sponsored it. I think Chris Garrett was at this meeting, and it was here at Scripps, and Chip Cox was there. And that's the first time I met Chip, and he and I huddled in the corner, and of course this was the Department of Energy was sponsoring because they're worried about subsea disposal of nuclear waste and what happened if the canisters leak, how quickly would it mix into the ocean. So the issue of bottom mixing was central. And Chip and I sat in the corner and he scratched out some equations and we thought, well, maybe it would be possible to measure chi in the deep ocean. I still think that's a big problem. But anyway, it inspired me. And then John Toole, my colleague, returned to HUI in 1982 after a postdoc with Stan Hayes, and he used a vertical profiler, much like we ended up building. It was called TOPS. And then John and I started really trying to go after the deep mixing problem with a pre-fault profiler that could get into the deep ocean and would combine shear and density measurements with microstructure measurements. So the high resolution profiler is what we came up with. We got DURUP funding from the Navy. And the key handling thing, which really made it a very usable instrument, was this sort of little railroad. We had a cart, you could hold the instrument horizontally and then flip it up, and it was also the winch that lowered it into the water. And it was long enough that the bottom of the instrument was still in the water, so it didn't swing like a pendulum too much. And there's the bottom business with it. Some of our group in the mid-90s, Alan Montgomery was key making all the data systems work. Dave Wellwood, good technician. There's John, Kurt Bolzen, Lou St. Laurent, myself, Francesco Paparella, who was a postdoc with the group for a little bit. So we built this thing in the early 80s, and we tried to deploy it on the Salt Finger region, but the air shipment took it to Trinidad instead of Barbados. And so that would have been our first cruise. Shortly thereafter that, we got a cruise in the FASTENEX experiment. That was a Navy project, and the Navy had built the instrument. And we deployed it, mostly shallow profiles, and Neil Oki came along to help us do microstructure. And the thing we were able to show was that here's a velocity profile, a nice inertial wave here. This was on the anticyclonic side of the subtropical front where you expect an inertial wave trapping. And we computed a Richards number, and you can see this is just the raw temperature gradient measurements. You can see the burst of mixing wherever you got a low Richards number. So this was a paper in Nature in 87. And here's a picture of John and I in our 30s. And I have to explain a little bit about John. Here's a picture of us in our 60s. And John he's the kind of guy who wears the same sweater for 30 years. Now, I think I'd reached my 30 years at HUI, and so someone had come up with that picture of us in our youth, and it was still lying around my office, and then one day he walked in with that sweater on. John is a fantastic colleague to work with. He is wonderful with data. Every time you walk into his office, there's data on his screen. Every time you walk into my office, there's a proposal on the screen. So I sort of did marketing, management, and maintenance. I'm a very technical sort of guy. And John did the data analysis. So it was a great team. And so we were quite happy with our results from the 86 cruise. But then we ran and hit the wall. There was this wonderful cartoon from the New Yorker. I don't know why I don't care about the bottom of the ocean, but I don't. And it seemed like the ONR program managers just didn't care about the bottom of the ocean, which is somewhat understandable. And Department of Energy had basically ceased to have any interest in oceanography. So we had trouble selling this for several years. We had about a 4-year hiatus in funding. We lost our technician. Anyway, but we kept working on the data. At the 87 paper, we published a paper on the HRP, and we had this basically 4-year funding hiatus. And Mike McCartney sent us a postcard with this picture on it. I think he was in Norway. It's a famous Norwegian painting. Two Viking warriors on skis protecting the young king. Mike was referring to our lack of success with ONR, and there was actually a fair bit of resistance to looking at microstructure at HUI. We were sort of looked askance at because everybody was worrying about the general circulation. So we fought a lot of battles then. But we finally broke through, and we did get some Navy funding to go to Fibrilling Gio in 91. And there the whole story became obvious. We saw a lot of mixing, this is K rho, mixing, the diffusivities were elevated when you got close to the seamount. And in the North Pacific, when you're away from the seamount, you didn't see very much. And we also combined this with the data from the North Atlantic Trace Release Experiment. And in that one, I convinced John to go. It was always a struggle to get John to take risk with the profiler. But we went deeper. I think we went to 5,000 meters in the abyssal plane heading back to the Canary Islands. And again, we didn't just, when the bottom was flat, we just didn't see much mixing. So the 90s were good to us. There's a picture of all the about 10 cruises we did. We did over 1,000 dives, and we always got it back. Sometimes it sat on the bottom for a few days. Easy to get these things stuck in the mud. There were actually a lot of innovations with the high-resolution profiler. We took the first Microvax to sea. We had to build our own PC with this special card format to fit in a 6-inch tube. This was before you could get a Raspberry Pi or a PC 104, which are a dime a dozen now. This was early days with the microprocessors. And the engineers were really excellent engineers. Ed Mellinger was responsible for the computer. He ended up at Mbari. And so when we did these, we did the topographic experiment, the topo experiment out of Fairfax in 91. We got funded to do the North Atlantic Trace Release Experiment, and that was an odd one. I had written two proposals that year, one to the Navy, one to ONR, and one to NSF. And the NSF project was to participate with Jim Ledwell in the North Atlantic Trace Release Experiment. And so we were waiting to hear about the results of that proposal. And Alan Brandt of the Navy, of the ONR, called me up. And he said, which project would you rather do? And I said, well, the North Atlantic Trace Release Experiment is a higher priority one. And so the Navy funded it, even though we had proposed it to NSF. It was in some ways embedded in the subduction experiment, which was the Navy-sponsored WOS project in that part of the North Atlantic. So anyway, we did get funding for a North Atlantic Trace Release Experiment, and this was really kind of a breakthrough. And in 1990, Jim Ledwell came to HUI. I like to take credit for recruiting him. I think he would have come anyway. I did find him a house in the neighborhood, so he's been a good neighbor living about a block away from us, Jim and Peg. So Jim coming to HUI really led to a lot more credibility. In effect, we could do the North Atlantic Trace Release Experiment. And you know, there had been sort of a lot of arguments in the microstructure community about statistics and sampling. And my attitude was to look more at the physics, the Richards number and the density ratio. And what, when we got out there and started doing HRP dives in the tracer experiment, it was pretty obvious what the answer was in 10 dives. You know, it was about 0.1 CGS. And of course, Jim didn't have the tracer answer for another year, so we didn't actually write an immediate paper after that one. But we did do some deep dives on the way back in. We didn't need to go deep for most of the nature dives, but we did do a few dives over a very smooth bottom with very little mixing. Then we started preparing the Brazil Basin experiment proposals, and the steering committee declined to endorse the microstructure component, but they wanted Ledwell to do his stuff. So in 94, we published the comparison of fever laying and North Atlantic trace release. And in 94, working with the French, we were able to get a cruise on a French vessel to the Romanche fracture zone. And there we saw enormous mixing. This is a crack in the mid-Atlantic ridge where Antarctic water is just flowing into the eastern basin. And lots of mixing. It was sort of like an underwater rapids, if you like. We did a nature paper on Romanche. And so we were really primed before the Brazil Basin cruise. And I laid out the cruise sample to sample both flat and rough topography, so we could show the variation of mixing rate in one figure. And basically, we wrote that science paper on the transit back to Recife. So here's the cruise plan. Notice quite a few dives away from the mid-ocean ridge where we were doing the experiment. And of course, early on, you want to test the instrument. And on the way home, nobody wants to do anything except steam. So it's a little bit of a fight to get these. But both of these sets are integrated into it. So, you know, we had in mind that if smooth bottom, there wouldn't be much mixing. Rough bottom, there wouldn't be mixing. And so here's an expanded version. We had the second cruise in 97. And we went a little further east, more over the peak of the ridge. And there's also a little malice and a forethought in planning that, which I'll explain. So in developing all this, Lou St. Laurent did his thesis work on trying to do an inverse problem. If we know what the mixing rate is from our measurements, can we characterize the flow? And this is one of the things that I think is really important. I'll show a map later. The Mid-Atlantic Ridge is cut by these transform faults, basically perpendicular to it. So they're running east-west. And what's shown in this figure, here's the bottom at the deepest depth at a given longitude. And here's the shallow. So here's the peaks of these transform faults, and here's the valley. And it's really there that you get the upwelling within these transform faults. And then out here, because we have the increasing mixing, we see downwelling. So there's downwelling up here. This is the stream function from Lou's inverse model. And maybe this picture, next one, shows some of the isopycnals diving into the bottom up one of the valleys. And Jim has a nice display of how the tracer moved. And you can see tracer was probably put in here somewhere, and the bulk of it mixed in this region. Some of it mixed, got into the bottom boundary layer in one of these valleys, and just basically got sucked up the valley. So this is relevant to some of our previous discussion. We still have somalarins. You still have a vertical divergence, but it's basically the deep water is getting sucked out from the bottom, and it's going up towards the peak of the ridge up these in these transform faults. And so there you have, here's where we're suggesting have forward flow due to the divergence of solarons. Because there's not mixing here, we have a mostly zonal flow. So that's the kind of picture that we would assemble from what we saw in the Brazil Basin experiment. The details of the topography really do seem to matter in this. So in 2000, Jim had enough tracer data from the 14-month and 26-month deployment. He could show how it dispersed laterally. This is the vertically integrated tracer. You can see it was injected here. It did move south, so it's moving forward, as you expect from some wearings, and dispersing. This blob here is really what's being sucked up the transform faults. So in cross-section, it looks a bit like this. And Jim has probably better figures of this in his poster. But one of the other things that a chief scientist can conspire to plan, during the 97 cruise, we had a lunar eclipse. So the tide was really cooking. So I planned it that we would be over the ridge when that happened. And this is vertically integrated dissipation. It's a function of time. And you can see that the dissipation that we were measuring was peaking a few days after the barotropic tidal speed estimates. And they were particularly strong. This one night, you can see the eclipse of the moon going on while you're over the ridge. It was really quite exciting. Now, the other thing we learned, and it's actually a different experiment, but I want to emphasize this point that no matter how strong the current, if you have a smooth bottom, you won't have much mixing. Kurt organized an experiment off of the U.S. East Coast, and this is a section across the Gulf Stream. We did a section across the Gulf Stream. So here's the current speeds, here's the Gulf Stream, and it's really here between 73 and 73 and a half is the main ocean current, the Gulf Stream current. And here's a section of dissipation, of diffusivity, and there's mixing over here, which is tidally driven on some ravines that are in the continental slope. But out here over the Gulf Stream, under the Gulf Stream, there's just not much going on. So if the bottom's smooth, no matter how strong the current, there's just not much mixing. So this is basically what I just said. Tides and topography are necessary for mixing. The mixing drives up canyon flows towards the mid-ocean ridges. The bottom intensification of mixing drives a downwardly divergent diapicnal velocity, and that drives a forward flow along the ridge flanks. The weak mixing above the flat abyssal plane suggests mostly zonal flows in the interior, and only weak mixing in a strong current if the bottom is smooth. And I like to point out to Raf and Trevor, the mixing should be in the middle, around the rough ridges, not on the smooth continental boundaries. So I wanted to change gears a little bit and talk about one of the unsolved problems. This is an approach that I learned from Mel Stern. It's basically using the variance equations that Chip Cox and others have used so fruitfully on the small scale. You can integrate those equations over the globe and ask yourself how much dissipation of thermal variance is required in the volume interior of the whole global ocean, given the fact that we heat it at high temperatures and cool it at low temperatures. And we can do that for temperature and salinity, and I've been working on surface flux products, the freshwater flux in particular. And you can convert that to spice and density. And Walter has talked about spice. In fact, he might have come up with the name. So the spice is sort of an imaginary parameter that's orthogonal to density in TS space. So here's a conventional temperature salinity diagram. And the density is the colors, and the dark lines are one version of spice. There's a number of ways to calculate it. So these global power integrals are just a nice way to figure out how much mixing we should be seeing in the ocean. And so here's the equations that we usually work with relating the heat flux down the temperature gradient to the dissipation. But if you take a step back, you can relate it to an area integral of the heat flux times the temperature. So that's the forcing of thermal variance, is the forcing of salinity variance, which is evaporation minus precipitation minus runoff times the salinity patterns. And you can relate that to the chi sub s dissipation of salinity variance. Well, you can do the same thing to density and spice. This is my graduate student did in his PhD thesis a couple years ago, and we've yet to publish it, but it's getting close now. So you can integrate the buoyancy flux over the surface of the total area of the ocean and the spice flux, and they would have the same units. And here's what the fluxes look like. Here's the heat flux, here's the fresh water flux, evaporation under the subtropical gyres, precipitation and under the ITCZ and high latitudes. And you can convert those to density flux and spice flux. And you do the sums, and here's what the pattern looks like. So here's heat flux as a function of temperature, salt flux as a function of salinity. And the fact that you have heat in at high temperatures and heat removed at low temperatures requires dissipation in the interior. And you can do the same for density and for spice, called tau here. And each of them is forced so that you have to have interior dissipation. And this is a little funny business in the Southern Ocean where basically water goes poleward to become lighter by fresh water fluxes. So using different flux products, and there are lots of them out there, you can also look at the effects, use a linearized equation of state, a nonlinear equation of state, you can add seasonal forcing and stuff. They're both about the same. Now, these figures very foolishly have, this is about 4 times 10 to the minus 6, and this is 0.4 times 10 to the minus 5. So the density variance production is the same as spice variance production. So what that means is that the amount of diapignal mixing in an ocean has got to be about the same as the amount of isopignal mixing in the ocean. And there's sort of a lot we need to do about isopignal mixing, and I would like to suggest that double diffusion is going to have a lot to do with it. These are some profiles of salinity and temperature in the North Atlantic Current off of Flemish Cap. Very strong interleaving, 1.5-2 degree temperature inversions. These are temperature compensated salinity inversions. So this is water of nearly different temperature and salinity properties interleaving very vigorously. And this was with Sandy Williams' profiler. We just could see some optical microstructure in some places, and it was very quiet in other places. And one thing you can do with SCIMP is we just had a qualitative classification of the optics, and you can see a nice peak of the optical microstructure occurred when the density ratio was between 0 and 2, which is both flavors of double diffusion. And it also increased when the Richards number was low. This mimics the pattern of available energy for mixing. And we've done a lot better job of looking at that sort of thing. So here I've contoured gamma, Oki's dissipation ratio, as a function of density ratio on the x-axis and the log of the Richardson number on the y-axis. And this is a doubly stable regime, no double diffusion possible, and we get the canonical 0.2 for that number. But when you're in the finger favorable regime, this is all data from Natri. We had lots of hints of salt fingers, but they weren't real strong. The number gets higher. It's up to 0.8, which is consistent with salt finger relationships. So we're seeing this nice signature of double diffusion in the case of the North Atlantic tracer release experiment. Another thing you can do is sort the look at chi as a function of Turner angle. So the center part here is the normal stable water mass where both temperature and salinity are stable. On the right, this is the salt finger quadrant, and this is the diffusive layering quadrant. We see this uptick in chi. This is a lot of statistics have gone into this. Actually, the proper number to look at is, this number down here, the blue, is the mean chi. The other one's just a standard deviation. But you see enhanced mixing whenever the enhanced dissipation of thermal variance whenever the conditions are favorable for salt fingers. So there's a lot of variance there, a lot of things we have to explain in the field of isopical mixing, and I think double diffusion on these intrusions has a lot to do with it. So, challenge for the future, find the rest of the mixing. If you take Moore's law and figure out how long it's going to be before a global model can resolve the dissipation scale of salinity, it's probably like 200 years. So. We'll still need people to go to sea and sample the ocean and parameterize it for the models. A few words to remember for students. Mel Stern, non-dimensionalize. You know, it guided my thinking, and it was quite useful in my career. John Knaus was on my committee, as I mentioned. And he was a good guy, and he had this one line which I appreciated. There's no limit to what you can accomplish if you don't have to take credit. And you know, I think it's a good advice for anyone. He also said, you will overestimate short-term progress and underestimate long-term progress. Things always seem to take longer on the projects you're doing, but then 10 years you look around and things have changed dramatically in fields that you weren't directly involved with. Carl Wunsch, one of my favorites. Just because it's in science or nature doesn't mean it's wrong. Chris, Carl says it belongs to you. I heard this line.
My point is Carl.
And then finally, I have one line from Walter that about 20 years ago, so I came to Scripps and very proudly showed that section in 1997, so it was 20 years ago. So Walter was 80 years old at that time, and he liked my talk, and he very kindly invited me to dinner at his home that evening. And we had this lovely dinner with Walter and Judith, and it got to be 9 o'clock, and Walter said, "Well, it's time for you to go," and this is why. Oh, sorry, forget that line. We like to go to bed early so there's time for sex. So. You know, coming from an 80-year-old man, I had a lot of admiration for him, and it's a great lesson for work-life balance. Thank you.
You mentioned that that vertical and lateral mixing are equally important in the measure of, I think, production of variance of density. Is there another measure that's perhaps more important than that one, the divergence of those, the lateral divergence of the lateral flux and the vertical?
Well, certainly for the circulation, the details of the circulation. These global power intervals just sort of set the overall constraint, and it doesn't tell you where the mixing is occurring. I find it quite interesting, and wonder. I mean, the models are tuned to the existing ocean, so I suspect that their isopical diffusivities and vertical diffusivities must fall out in somehow in this ratio. You know, at the mesoscale, or to whatever resolve scale you have in the model, you're absorbing isopycnal variances as much as you are absorbing diapycnal variance. But the details of how that impacts the circulation remains to be seen. And where the mixing occurs, like this complex circulation that we're seeing in these canyons near the mid-ocean ridges.
Yeah, I guess my question really was, the power intervals have shown you that the vertical elements are actually important by some measure.
Yeah.
And I'd like to understand better how it could be important by some other measure.
Yeah. Well, perhaps it gets back to your question about, is there any energy expended in horizontal processes? My colleague Xin Wang has been worrying about this a little bit. There's some subtle problems there. Energetically, isopycnal mixing would seem to require no energy, and we don't have a dynamical use for spice. You know, it's sort of a tracer, passive tracer. So there's some interesting questions there, but I don't have the answers. Yes.
Maybe a very stupid question. When you have all these changes with the methane release on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, you know, that there are a lot of papers dealing with the, what do you call them? Do you have this methane?
Methane release?
Methane releases. And you know, these are like chimneys going out.
Yeah.
Is there any effect on that?
I wouldn't know. Is there much methane released on the ridge? I mean, I think it comes out of the sediments. I think you have to. There are plumes. There's a lot of heat, and so you have these hot smokers and whatnot.
Yeah. That's what I mean.
Okay. Yeah. I don't think it's so much methane, but yeah. I believe. Andreas Thurner and Lou St. Laurent are doing some more detailed looks at that sort of thing. Well, yeah, the beta plume, right. There's probably quite a bit that could be done in terms of modeling what these interior buoyancy fluxes are doing. You know, you have flux convergences and divergences, and that's got to affect the circulation. The hot smokers are so localized. Yeah, I don't know how you generalize to a larger, larger circulation.
Well, I mean, some of my colleagues in Berlin, they have located, very accurately.
You know, one other thing, fun thing about mixing, if no one has a question, I'll just ramble on about something. If you think about how the ocean is heated at high temperatures and cooled at low temperatures, the buoyancy flux is not balanced. That is, the thermal expansion coefficient is higher at high temperatures, right? So we're putting more buoyancy into the ocean than we're extracting. This was discussed back in 1989 at a Liège conference. And this imbalance in the buoyancy flux is absorbed by contraction on mixing, which we call cavalling, one of those nonlinear effects of the equation of state. So That's a fun fact, and we've been able to estimate its magnitude, and it's several times the rate of sea level rise. That is the mix. If you could stop all mixing in the ocean, it would start to rise at something like almost 10 centimeters a year or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, this is the last talk of the morning session, so just listening to the talks, I mean, I think we all agree that we are talking about mixing, but my question is if in practical terms we are talking about the same thing. So like you talk about measurements of processes at very small scales, and then we have talks on boundary, like upwelling around boundary, which is talking about buoyancy flux in a time, space, average sense. Then we saw Mike showing some plots from Saman Passage where you have overturns that are 500 meters, and Kurt is talking about a mixed layer which is 2 meters. And then some. I mean, we talk about diffusivity, sometimes we talk about epsilon, and through mixing efficiency we infer diffusivity, and sometimes we talk about the epecmal velocity versus flux. So like for someone that doesn't know anything about any of what we do, what is mixing?
Mixing is the destruction of variance. Right? It's when you have a gradient in temperature and you mix it and remove that gradient, you've destroyed the temperature variance. And same for salinity. And so we've had to do, and in the process of homogenizing it, we realized that we have to replace the cold water in the deep ocean. So that's why it all relates to the meridional overturning circulation. Trevor, you want to say what is mixing?
Mixing is like pornography. It's hard to define, but when you see it, you know what it is. I do have a question for you, Ray. You mentioned double diffusion, both salt ringing and diffusive type. How, in your considered view, how important would those two pure one-dimensional processes be compared to the lateral intrusions that are driven by double diffusion?
Intrusions are still a hard problem, hard observational problem. I think a lot of the neutrally buoyant floats and AUVs that people are working with now, I can see that can be a rich observational field in the next few years. One thing I will say about the North Atlantic Trace Release Experiment, the diapicnal flux of salt in salt fingers is larger than the diapicnal flux of heat. That's just a energetic constraint. And it ends up having a negative diffusivity for the density. And if you combine sort of the we had about a 0.05 times 10 to the minus 4 CGS, or I'm sorry, mixing coefficient for density from the turbulence, from the wave breaking, and we had kind of an equal and opposite buoyancy flux from the salt fingers. So I think that's why the ventilated thermocline theories work so well. The actual net buoyancy flux in the main thermocline is pretty small because the salt fingers are fighting the internal waves. Now, you go to other regions like off Barbados where there's strong thermohaline staircases, and there the salt fingers dominate, they suppress the internal waves, and they provide vertical diffusivity for salt in the main thermocline of order 1 CGS units. So, and Jim's tracer shows that. So there are regions, and they're not that small. It's about 1 million square kilometers, the Barbados thermohaline staircase.
Thank you.
It's you're mixing horizontal and vertical processes, and the observational challenges are pretty steep at the moment.
Okay, thank you, Ray.
We now have lunch outside, and to complicate things a little bit, I've asked our senior guests and speakers to not sit next to their long-lost friends, but to actually leave room for some of the younger folks in the audience to sit next to them. So the goal is to maximize the standard deviation of age, experience, and the general nastiness at each table. And so I'll ask younger folks in the audience to help out and take advantage of that. If this works, we'll do it again tomorrow. If it doesn't, we'll just relax, but try for now. That's, I think,